Well, good morning. Welcome to the Boonesboro Bible Church Gatekeeper Sunday School class here in Boonesboro, Maryland. My name is Ernie Best, and today is December the 11th, the year of our Lord 2022. It's great to be back. This is my first Sunday back from my recovery from my surgery. And I want to thank everyone for their prayers and their thoughts. And we're going to get back into our study of the book of Proverbs. We're on chapter 23. And chapter 23 has 35 verses. And we're under the heading Roman numeral 4, Proverbs of Wise Men. And the overriding theme of chapter 23 are warnings. Warnings about things like money, gluttony, speaking in the company of a fool, dishonesty, withholding discipline from a child, keeping company with drunkards, and the abuse of alcohol. The description of alcohol's risk is actually the most extensive such caution that we read in Scripture in the book of Proverbs. The first 23 verses, Solomon talks about greed and gluttony. And then the next two verses, verses 24 and 25, we look at the value of proper child discipline. And then the last 10 verses, he talks about sexual sins should be taken very seriously. And not only that, they should be avoided. In the previous chapter, Solomon introduces a series of 30 wise sayings. It runs from Proverbs chapter 22, verse 17 through 21, which endorses, yet did not necessarily, Solomon didn't write them himself. The first five were found in chapter 22, and the 6th through the 18th are found in this passage we're studying this morning. Greed and gluttony. Beginning in verse 1, 2, and 3, Solomon writes, "When you sit down to eat with a ruler, consider carefully what is before you. Put a knife to your throat if you are a man given to appetite. Do not desire his delicacies, for they are deceptive food." Here in these verses, we are warned against gluttony, or the overindulgence of food or drink. When we eat with an influential person, we should consider what or who this person is. Then we should put a knife to our throat, that is, exercise restraint in eating or drinking. Verse 3 suggests that someone might be whining and dining us in order to influence us in some way. It isn't a case of unselfish hospitality, but a means of using us for some subtle person, a purpose. Verses 4 and 5 says, "Do not overwork to be rich because of your own understanding. Cease. Will you set your eyes on that which is not? For riches certainly makes themselves wings. They fly away like an eagle toward heaven." That ceaseless struggle to be rich is a form of wisdom to be avoided. It means that you're spending your life pursuing false values and putting your trust in what does not last. Riches have a way of sprouting wings and flying away like an eagle. Verses 6 through 8 says, "Do not eat the bread of a miser, nor desire his delicacies. For as he thinks in his heart, so he is. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. The morsel you have eaten, you will vomit up and waste your pleasant words." So he's talking about another social situation to avoid. Don't be a guest of a man who has an evil eye. A miser who begrudges you every little bite of food you eat. It's what he thinks, not what he says, that counts. For while he's saying, help yourself, have some more, eat and drink, he's actually counting every spoonful that you take. Don't associate with evil men. Don't long for their favors and gifts, the kindness of a trick. They want to use you as a pawn. The delicious foods they serve you will turn sour in your stomach, and you will vomit it out and have to take back your words of appreciation for their kindness. And in verse 9, it says, do not speak in the hearing of a fool. He will despise the wisdom of your words. Don't try to teach a dull, stupid fool. You're wasting your time on it. He will despise your words of wisdom. Verse 10 and 11, it says, do not remove the ancient landmark, nor enter the fields of the fatherless. For the Redeemer is mighty. He will plead their case against you. What he's saying is, don't dishonestly take the property of somebody else by secretly moving the ancient boundary stones. Don't take advantage of the defenseless by seizing their property, because their avenger is mighty. You'll have to deal with him. He will plead their case against you. Verse 12, apply your heart to instruction and your ears to words of knowledge. There is no easy way to gain instruction. It requires discipline, and it requires an application, making an effort to learn. Disregard the ads that promised it in three easy lessons. Verse 13 and 14, do not withhold correction from a child, for if you beat him with a rod, he will not die. You shall beat him with a rod and deliver his soul from hell. You see, it's not a kindness to a child to allow him to run wild. The Bible does not condone impassiveness, but rather encourages correction with a rod and the promise that the child will not die. This may mean that the beating will not kill him, or that the beating will actually save him from premature, reckless death. It will deliver his soul from hell. Instead of disciplining his wicked son, Eli rebuked them with a mild, why do you do these things? Back in 1 Samuel 2, verses 22 through 25. You see, Eli, he fostered a permissiveness that wrought ruin on his house, wrought ruin on the priesthood and on the nation. David failed in that the area of parental discipline as well. He never displeased Adonijah by correcting him in 1 Kings 1:6. After making two treasonous steps to seize the throne, Adonijah was killed by Solomon. Verse 15 and 16, it says, my son, if your heart is wise, my heart will rejoice indeed, I myself. Yes, my innermost being will rejoice when your lips speak right things. A father rejoices when his son has a heart that is wise and lips that speak the truth. The teacher experiences the same joy when his pupil receives wisdom and he shares it with others. In a similar vein, Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 3:8, for now we live if we stand fast in the Lord. And John said in John 3:4, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. verses 17 and 18, do not let your heart envy sinners, but be zealous for the fear of the Lord all the day. For surely there is a hereafter, and your hope will not be cut off. There is something better than envying the prosperity of the wicked, that is to live in constant fellowship with the Lord. Occupation with the wicked brings discouragement. Occupation with the Lord brings delight. So the lesson is to make communion with God the aim of our life. Also remember that there is a future day of reckoning for the wicked and a bright hope and reward for the righteous, which shall never be disappointed. The hereafter looks past death and resurrection to the glorious future in heaven. Verse 19, hear, my son, and be wise, and guide your heart in the way. Whatever others may do, an obedient son should heed instruction. He should be wise and guide his heart in the right way, and the right way is God's way. Verse 20 and 21, do not mix with winebibbers or with gluttonous eaters of meat. For the drunkard and the glutton will come to poverty, and the drowsiness will clothe a man with rags. He's saying there are two kinds of drunkards, those who drink too much and those who eat too much. They both make bad company for anyone who wants a good life. Intemperance takes its toll. The drunkard and the glutton are headed for poverty. The stupor which results from the overindulgence in food and drink will clothe a man in rags. Verse 22, listen to your father who begat you, and do not despise your mother when she is old. Young people should welcome advice from their father and not treat their mother with contempt. Old folks have years of experience behind them. Young people should recognize this and try to benefit as much as possible from the older people's experiences. Verse 23, buy the truth and do not sell it. Also wisdom and instruction and understanding. We should be willing to pay a great price for truth, but unwilling to sell it for any consideration. The same goes for wisdom and instruction and understanding. We should spare no pain to acquire them, but never surrender them for anything in this world. Letter B in your outline, verses 24 and 25, is titled The Value of Proper Child Discipline. Verse 24 and 25. The father of the righteous will greatly rejoice, and he who begats a wise child will delight in him. Let your father and your mother be glad. Let her who bore you rejoice. You see, modern custom says, give father a tie on Father's Day and mother a box of chocolates on Mother's Day. But more rewarding to parents is a son who lives wisely and prudently. Hence the exhortation, let your father and your mother be glad, and let her who bore you rejoice. Letter C in your outline, sexual sins should be taken seriously and avoided. Verses 26 through 35 to the end of the chapter. Verse 26 through 28 says, my son, give me your heart and let your eyes observe my ways. For a harlot is a deep pit, and a seductress is a narrow well. She also lies in wait for a victim and increases the unfaithful among men. The earnest plea, my son, give me your heart, introduces solemn warnings against immorality and drunkenness. The writer says, listen to me. Listen to me carefully and observe the counsel that I give you. A prostitute is like a deep, concealed pit forming a trap for the careless. She is a narrow well, easy to fall into, but so very hard to get out of. She lies in wait like a robber. She may have a pathological hatred for men and wreaks her revenge on them by entangling them through deception. Like one hooks a fish with a lure. Daily, she adds to the list of unfaithful men whose marriages and families are torn apart by immorality. Verses 29 and 30. Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contentions? Who has complaints? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Those who linger long at the wine, those who go in search of mixed wine. The rest of chapter 23 is a classic description of the drunkard. He brings all kind of trouble on himself and staggers from one sorrow to another. His life is marked by his contention, since he's always trying to pick a fight. He grumbles and complains incessantly, but it never dawns on him that he is the cause of all his own troubles. He has bruises and wounds, a black eye, all from fights that were unnecessary. His eyes are bleary and bloodshot. He sits in the tavern all night consuming one mixed drink after another. Verses 31 and 32, do not look on the wine when it is red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it swirls around smoothly. At the last, it bites like a serpent and stings like a viper. So he is warned against being fascinated by this clear red wine, by its brilliant sparkle, by the way it swirls so smoothly around the cup. But he doesn't listen, and so he suffers the consequences, which is like a bite of a serpent and a sting of a viper, poisonous and painful. Verses 33 and 34, your eyes will see strange things, and your heart will utter perverse things. Yes, you will be like one who lies down in the midst of the sea, or like one who lies at the top of the mast, saying, his eyes will see strange things. A possible reference to the horrors of delirium. The violent mental disturbances caused by excessive and prolonged use of liquor. His conversation is thick, garbled, and vile. He reels to and fro unsteadily as he were bobbing back and forth in a sea, or perched on top of a mast as it rocks crazily from side to side. Verse 35, they have struck me, but I was not hurt. They have beaten me, but I did not feel it. When shall I awake that I may see another drink? Someone has knocked him out. But when he regains consciousness, he says he wasn't hurt. They beat him like a rented mule, but he didn't even feel it at all. As soon as he came back to his wits, he plans to go right back to the bar and have another drink. So there are many things we can learn from chapter 23. So what are they? What do these words teach us today, right now, in our lives? Well, in the first 11 verses, it says that greed and gluttony are dangerous, even when enjoying hospitality of a host. It thinks it's important not to appear to take undue advantage of the host's generosity. At the same time, one should be careful not to allow generosity to sway good judgment. A cynical, impulsive host should be avoided, since their charity is a pretext for a bribe. Wealth itself is tempting, but part of godly wisdom is knowing when to stop chasing profit. This segment repeats warnings about fraud in the form of moving boundary markers and the pointless exercise of trying to educate hard-headed fools. And then from verses 12 to 25, reminders about the value of proper child discipline. In this context, the intent is to help children learn to make good choices in tune with God's will. Those who grow into adults and follow such teachings bring their parents joy as a part of their perspective. Solomon encourages the reader not to be jealous of those who engage in sin. Their hope is limited, while those who honor God can look forward to eternity. The passage warns about being associated with people who lack self-control, not only when their morality influences others, but when they can also cause collateral damage with their own poor choices in life. And then from verse 26 to the end of the chapter, verse 35, in this final section, says, yes, sexual sins should be taken seriously and they should be avoided. The danger of lust is compared to a trap or to an ambush from a robber. This advice is followed by the Bible's most extensive, detailed warning about the dangers of alcohol abuse. Overconsumption leads to personal troubles, side effects, and a host of other dangers. While Scripture does not forbid the use of alcohol, it clearly labels drunkenness as a sin in Ephesians 5:18. So it should be avoided altogether. It can ruin the witness of a person. The Bible also explains in direct terms what can happen when someone consumes alcohol carelessly. If you have never put your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you need to ask yourself this question: why do I need a Savior? Well, the answer is that humanity needs a Savior. To give an exhaustive answer to why we need a Savior, it'd require encyclopedia volumes of information. But in my limited time here this morning, I will present some ideas based on what the Bible says about why we need a Savior. First, let's understand the term "we" in this question. To be technically inclusive, that is, when we say we need a Savior, we mean that every person who has ever lived needs a Savior. We should note that the term Savior enjoys somewhat of a broad use in the Bible. Anyone who performs an act of rescue or deliverance may be designated as a Savior. Example includes Judges Othniel and Ehud in Judges 3, 9, and 15. God himself, and not just Jesus specifically, is called a Savior in Isaiah 43, 11, 45, 21 through 22, and Isaiah 60, verse 16. So in order to avoid confusion, I will use the word Savior to designate Jesus Christ. The reason we need a Savior has its roots in the nature of God and the nature of man. First, the Bible says God has a plan, and human beings are critical to that plan. Second, God is holy, and he cannot abide in sin. And third, every human being has sinned. Every human has an intrinsic sin nature. The difficulty for us is that living with God requires sinless perfection. And none of us is perfect. So God cannot accomplish his goals without first fixing mankind. That's why we need a Savior. And the scripture identifies him as Jesus Christ, Luke 2:11 and Titus 2:13 and 14. We need a Savior because we need to be made holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Hebrews 12:14. Jesus does not simply make us better people, nor does he boost our godliness or augment our holiness, because we have none to begin with. Rather, he makes us completely new creatures. 2 Corinthians 5:17 and Galatians 6:15. The plan of God for mankind, we need a Savior, because God's plan for us is to bring glory to him. Isaiah 43:7. And enjoy his fellowship forever. Psalm 27:4. He desires to conform us to the image of his Son. Romans 8:29. The self-existent one did not create the cosmos to entertain himself. He did so to cultivate relationships with beings made in his image. Genesis 1:27. God, as a social and moral agent, desires to have his creation love him and thrive. The fact that we fell into sin and rebellion means that we need a Savior, or God's plan for us cannot be realized. In his love, God sent the Savior, his only begotten Son, so he could fit us for eternity and showcase his glory, the holiness of God. With over 900 biblical references to the holiness of God, its importance to his creation cannot be overstated. The Bible teaches that we should pursue holiness. 1 Peter 1:15. Jesus taught that we should approach God with the understanding that he alone is holy, Matthew 6:9. We need a Savior because God is too pure to abide sinfulness. Habakkuk 1:13 says, your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrongdoing. And Matthew 7:23, it says, without a Savior, God's word to us will only be away from me, you evildoers. And then the sinfulness of mankind in Romans 10:10-18, Paul brings passages from Psalms and Isaiah into discussion of the law. In doing so, he uses scripture to conclude with confidence that every person has sinned. Romans 3:23. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Every person, therefore, requires remediation. We cannot cast out our sin any more than a leper can change his spots. Jeremiah 3:13 says, there is no one righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:10 and Psalm 14:1. God says in those uncertain terms that everyone is a sinner, even the one who don't think they are. 1 John 1:8. What this means is that everyone needs a Savior, even those who don't think they need a Savior. The necessity of a Savior is without question. To summarize, God has a plan, and his plan is perfect, and he won't change his mind about executing his plan. His plan involves us humans, though we are sinners through and through, Since God is holy, he cannot tolerate the presence of sin, and unless he somehow cleanses us, it is impossible for him to work his eternal plan with us. Those who are cleansed, those who are not saved, must be separated from God for all eternity. So what's the solution? What's God's solution? God's solution is to offer the perfect sacrifice once for all to cleanse us of sin and reconcile us to himself. This he did with his son on that cruel cross. We need a savior because we can't save ourselves. We need a savior because without Christ, we are described as having no hope and without God in the world. Ephesians 2:12. We need a savior, and God has provided one. Jesus saves us as a demonstration of God's love, as a function of his mercy. Titus 3:7 says, having been justified by grace, we become heirs of the hope of eternal life. You see, Jesus' sacrifice unlocked everything for us. And if there is any other way for us to work his plan without compromise, he would have chosen that over the humiliation of the cross. Luke 22:42. The fact that Jesus did indeed die on the cross is proof that we need a Savior. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word, so perfect and true. And Father, I pray anyone in the hearing of these words that understands that they are a sinner and they are in need of a Savior, that they need to repent and turn from their sin and trust Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And Father, I pray that you would touch each and every one this morning and bring them to that understanding, to realize that they need a Savior and there's no hope without the Savior, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for being such a awesome God, full of grace and glory. And we pray it in his holy name. Amen and amen. Next week, we'll move on to Proverbs chapter 24. It has 34 verses. We're still under that Roman numeral 4 heading of Proverbs of Wise Men. And the theme of chapter 24 is additional wise statements which are not as clearly attributed to King Solomon. The first 12 verses talk about a true success is found in wisdom, leading to strength and good reputation. And then the next few verses is letter B in your outline. All things God gives have a good and valuable purpose. And then finally, the last few verses, letter C in your outline, Solomon again stresses the importance of fair judgment from verses 23 to 34. I want to thank you for tuning in today, and I want to remind you that at 10:30, Pastor Allen will be here with the morning message. And the title of his message this morning is The Gift of Peace, which is out of the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verse 6. So again, thank you for tuning in this morning, and thank you for studying God's word, because it is so necessary. If you are serious about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you want to know what God has in store for you, he will speak to you through his word. So it's so vital that we study God's word on a daily basis. So I want to thank you, and God bless each and every one of you.